What's up, guys? It's Scott Kinmartin here. Tonight, I wanted to share with you a story that comes from Tim Joyce, the brother of the late Tom Joyce, who was my English professor in college and my favorite professor of all time. I consider him a close friend, and I was devastated when I heard the news last week while in Portland of his passing. Now, he struggled with cancer several times for many years, but it eventually got the best of him. I miss him. I send my condolences to his family and loved ones, and I wanted to share with you a story that Tim Joyce posted tonight on his Facebook. Now, this is more of him venting and kind of trying to figure out life, but he's definitely grieving, and I felt like his words were beautiful and could maybe teach you a lesson or two on how to deal with life and possibly death. Here goes. So I'm left again with the task of late night wondering. It will not offend me if some of you who read this say, "Geez, get over it already. Talk about something else." That is the shroud I too wish to cast off. It dumbfounds me as I walk the street or ride along a highway to think that there must be others passing by who are also in a state of recent loss. The bargain of existence is a hard one indeed. It certainly is no negotiation by any standard that makes sense to me. One side names the price, sends the bill, and ultimately collects the payment. That is a life if you look at it as a transaction. Something tells me tonight, and among many previous happier nights, that this metaphor is absurdly flawed, however. We do not buy or sell or lease or rent our existence. Something much more precious, much more fragile, something of greater worth than anything that can be numbered is what a life is. This current numbness, interrupted only by tears, interrupted only by unawareness, interrupted only by the hope that strangers passing by are having better days. All of that is grief. It is nothing bought or sold, given or taken away. I have three brothers. One is now counted among the non-living. There's no deal to be made anymore. I know the truth. I kissed his face in his casket and held his hand while I sang the warmth of the sun to his inert body. It was cleansing, because I knew he heard the song and felt my longing, but that the object I sang to was no more my brother than a bar of soap or a pair of pliers. That body, that collection of matter, gave away, lost its power to move and breathe. I cannot poeticize that this spirit is something that will answer the telephone or reply to a letter in my remaining time in this field of light through which I'm left to walk. He is indeed dead, and indeed, I am alive. Right now, it seems neither understandable or senseless. I am merely in a state of being that is diminished by that cold body we left to be planted in a field. I remember reading about Allen Ginsberg and his time in India. He worked for quite a while in the ghats, the cremation places where the Hindus brought their newly dead to be changed by fire into heat energy and ash. He spoke so calmly of the naturalness of it all. Empty, soulless bodies being reformed for reposition. Weeping families laughing simultaneously at the joyful transformation that takes a soul somewhere new, unknown, and unknowable. It sounds exciting as well as dreadful. Allen knew something from the experience that called him to peace inside. I lack his wisdom or the ability at this moment to make it mine. I want my brother back in this now, this existence. I am a product of the land that raised me and the God I was given the task of figuring out. I want. And all the answers are variations on no, with differing degrees of hope or politeness. On the street and in their cars, my fellow grieving strangers are checking the dashboard dials just like me and wondering whether looking for meaning within the ride is just a fool's errand. I am of this world for this moment. I want to know the lesson of the ghats without the pain or effort. How awfully American I am right now. How dearly I wish to talk to him while he occupies his body. How very little I know except that I love him, but now must learn to say that in a past tense or sound deluded. The theories are in place. I know the wording of the rules, if not their purpose or sense. A long journey is beginning, and not only has the train not even left the station yet, the engineer has overslept and only now is getting into his place in the locomotive. It begins, it ends. It does neither, perhaps. All I have to guide me is a ticket for a seat in the club car, and I hope that the view from the window is comforting. Good night. Last call for this line has been announced, and they don't hold the motion for anyone. Once again, that is a lovely story from Tim Joyce. I found that to be beautiful. And the lesson here is that life is about the journey, not the destination.